It's critical in the manufacture and operation of life-saving equipment and vital in our technology-driven world. That's helium gas. But world supplies have been dwindling for years. That is, until two businessmen stumbled upon ridiculously high concentrations of helium on a piece of land they bought for another purpose entirely in the Free State. Hard to believe? Well, here's Claire.
It can hit the Earth or not?
Around 2 billion years ago, planet Earth was struck by an asteroid, resulting in the Freda Fort Dome, the world's largest known crater.
Fast forward a billion years or so, an IT guy and a banker buy a piece of land around Virginia in the Free State that has gas exploration rights and some wells in it. They are looking at starting a small sideline business to supply natural gas as a substitute for diesel to mines in the area.
We saw this rusted pipe sticking out the ground. There was something blowing from within. We were told it was methane. And we said, this is a great idea.
Nick Mitchell and Steph Marani bought the land in 2013. With gas exploration rights from neighboring farms, the area measures 187,000 hectares.
The idea was quite simple. Rent a few gas-powered generators, put them on top of the wellheads, and then feed power into one of the gold mines nearby. And it was literally just going to be a tiny little project.
In the course of doing the deal, a gas sample was required.
So in a panic, we drove down, we collected the samples, we drove them back immediately to the laboratories and we had them analyzed.
The lab results showed a concentration of 2% helium in their methane gas.
All Nick and Steph knew about helium is that it's a gas used in balloons to make them float. So they did their research and discovered how vital helium is in our modern world.
And I'm looking at this piece of paper and I see 2% helium in it and ask Nick, like, listen, what do you know about helium? And he's like, balloons. And so we asked Dr. Google.
What we discovered firstly was MRIs. An MRI or CAT scan can't operate without helium.
So they researched who the manufacturers of the MRIs are so they could sell their helium to them.
And so we eventually cold call someone in New York and they ask us how much helium we have. We say 2% and the conversation ends. And so we then phone another gas company. We get to the 2% mark and the conversation ends.
But I suppose we're quite persistent. Our last call was to Linde, the industrial gases company, and we spoke to one of the engineers in Germany, and he said, you know, for the amount of times he's heard someone say that they've got 2% helium, if he had a dollar for each one of those moments, he'd be quite rich.
You don't have any helium in your gas. It's too rare.
We said, well, that's quite interesting because it was your laboratory that ran these samples.
Linde HQ sent out some of their scientists to rerun the tests. It was confirmed Renogen, Steph and Nick's company, had 2% helium.
Steph and I looked across from each other. We didn't say anything. We were too cool and calm for that. But we knew we've got something quite special on our hands here.
Helium is not only critical in the manufacture of life-saving equipment, but a world without helium would mean a world without TV, cell phones, computers, microchips. We couldn't launch rockets or satellites.
It's pretty fundamental to absolutely every aspect. So the consequences of not having helium are pretty far-reaching.
To put this in perspective, there are only 7 countries, now 8 including South Africa, that produce helium.
The lowest concentration is Qatar. They're extracting it at around 0.01%. The United States is around 0.35%, and they are truly the helium rock stars. And now all of a sudden, you've got a field where the worst well is 2%.
The reason for the high concentration of helium goes back around 2 billion years to the asteroid strike.
There was a humongous explosion. It was so intense that the rocks were forced down as a result of the impact, and then they squirted back up. Because of the intensity of this explosion, the rocks behaved almost like water. They solidified quite quickly, so they trapped the shape.
Leading expert on the geology of South Africa, Professor Terence McCarthy, finds this Freda Fort area a treasure trove.
These rocks that lie underneath the Fierder Fort structure that were folded down and preserved contain a lot of gold, but they also contain a lot of uranium. This massive meteorite impact that sucked these rocks down into this hollow and protected them from later erosion and kept them secure. It's just one of those miracles, and that's why this deposit has produced 40% of all the gold ever mined in history.
Bacteria incorporated into the rock survived, producing methane gas. And the uranium, which is decaying into lead, is producing helium.
Now, along the way, they give off like little bullets of helium. And because of the structure that Fierder Fort created, this deep infolding, stuff hasn't been allowed to escape. So the helium slowly migrates into little fractures and fills, eventually fills fissures.
And together with the methane, the helium traveling through the cracks reaches the surface.
In the world of geology, this is a unique phenomenon. Usually gas wells last for around 15 years, but gas wells that were drilled here in the 50s and 60s are still producing helium-bearing gas.
This well alone by itself is about an average producer for us, and it's still blowing at the same rate today that it was back in 1972. This thing has produced over 200,000 kilograms of helium, and there has not been a decline in the concentration of helium.
What makes this discovery miraculous is the fact that the helium is part of an ongoing biological process, making the gas completely renewable.
Will the helium continue to be produced?
Yeah, it will regenerate. It'll continue to regenerate, but we can't say whether it's going to happen at the same rate as we extract it. But in the meantime, the resources of helium are huge. You know, we've only just started.
This comes at a time when there is a worldwide helium crisis. The United States government's Strategic Reserve, the Bureau of Land Management, BLM, has virtually run dry of their stockpiled helium.
The BLM is now empty. That was 30% of the world's helium supply in any given year. Shortly after that, we got funding from the United States government. They gave us a loan of $40 million to test the feasibility of extracting helium from South Africa.
Helium is a supercritical element. Any source known to the world or the market has got attention on it. Ours happens to be a source with the world's highest concentrations recorded.
We're all concerned about harming the environment, so is extracting the helium doing any damage to surrounding areas?
No. It's a win-win thing, you know, because you simply drill a hole and let it flow out on its own. The trick is to drill the hole in the right place, and that's a challenge. The gas is so light that it just escapes through the atmosphere.
In December last year, Renergen made another off-the-chart discovery.
By fate and chance, we intersected a fault as we started to pull the equipment out so that we could start going in a more lateral position. The sensors went off the charts.
And we hit, by accident, a fault that we didn't even know existed, where you've got helium coming up at 12%. If you're mining for gold and you're used to mining for gold at 5 grams per ton, this would be like striking 1,000 grams per ton.
Two businessmen who 7 years ago knew so little about helium now have the richest commercial recoverable source of this precious commodity.
I think sometimes it's the lack of knowledge of what you're getting into that probably helps with the discovery in the first place.
And South Africa becomes a major supplier of this critical gas.
We become a net exporter of helium as opposed to an importer. That means that we're now receiving cash as opposed to paying cash out. From a scientific perspective, it's important because we are now a helium producer in a very exclusive little club. We were at a conference in Houston in 2018. You had 98% of the entire world's helium suppliers in one room. You had 95% of the entire world's helium consumers in one room, and all of the equipment manufacturers. And the room only had 300 people in it. But now South Africa joins that exclusive little club.
It's evolved slowly. It's definitely a lot bigger than what we thought the first day we saw this rusted pipe. Do we think it's reached its pinnacle? Absolutely not. We're just taking one day at a time.